Okay, welcome back, folks. We are into the study of popular music of the 1950s and 60s. Probably a heavy concentration on rock and roll, but definitely we're covering other types of music like the blues and country music and soul music, rhythm and blues. So we're kind of just hitting everything as we can. So as I do every day, let's bring this in with good old Bob Seger. Okay, so trivia question for the day. Carl Perkins' biggest hit was Blue Suede Shoes. On what nationally televised show did he make his national TV debut singing this song? Okay, the show was right here in Springfield, Missouri, the Ozark Jubilee, March 17th, 1956. Carl and his Perkin Brothers band performed his hit song for the first time on the Ozark Jubilee. From there, he went back to Nashville, and then he was headed up to New York City to get his gold record on the Perry Como show and to introduce his show on a bigger network show. Unfortunately, Carl had a serious car wreck, which we'll talk about in a few weeks, and all but destroyed his career as a rockabilly artist. So, just had gotten started. A lot of people thought he was going to be bigger than Elvis, but his career kind of got derailed. But boy, does his song live on. It's still played all the time. So we're finishing up 1955 today. So let's kind of review what we've talked about so far as we close our discussion of popular music for that year. We first saw how Bill Haley and his Comets recorded Rock Around the Clock, was introduced to the public by the movie Blackboard Jungle, became the first rock and roll hit. And then we saw how the Chords recording of Shaboom and the Penguins recording of Riff Angel kind of started the doo-wop craze, which would just continue to grow over the next two decades. We saw the Platters emerge as the first great rock and roll group with their recording of Only You. And at the same time, Ray Charles was kind of laying the groundwork for soul music with I've Got a Woman. Up in Chicago, Lynyrd Skynyrd was recording blues music with the likes of Muddy Waters, Howlin' Wolf, Little Walter. And then he started venturing into the rock and roll genre with a man that he called Bo Diddley. Now, all this kind of was really having an effect upon the parents of America. They just saw rebellion. They saw chaos. They saw all bad things with this early rise of rock and roll. Fortunately for the music, Fats Domino and Pat Boone came around. And they seemed to calm the fears and kind of calm the waters and allowed the music to go on. It's probably a good thing that we talked last week about how they came along, because the next big artists were Chuck Berry, who became the first real rock and roll star and kind of put all the elements together. A lot of people really say that Chuck Berry kind of invented rock and roll with his first big hit, Maybelline. And then we saw how Little Richard just absolutely blew the lid off the pot with Tutti Frutti and scared the daylights out of parents all over America. Finally, we examined the early career of a lady by the name of Laverne Baker, who had a very early hit called Twiddly Dee, as well as several others, CeCe Ryder, several more, and made her the first real female rock and roll star. Up to this point, it had been kind of an all-boys club. So that's what we've looked at so far the last couple of weeks. So let's look at what I call my pick song of the week today. Nat King Cole. Nat King Cole was just a fantastic singer. He was known for so many songs, was one of the first Black people to have his own TV show, as well as his own radio show. Suffered a lot for it, had some really bad incidents in his life, died of a very early age, just 45 years of age. Of course, his daughter came along later and became a star herself of music, and she died fairly early in her 50s. But the guy could really, really sing. So let's listen to Nat King Cole sing one of his great classics.
The falling leaves drift by the window. The autumn leaves of red and gold. I see your lips, the sunburned kisses, the sunburned hands I used to hold since you went away. The days roll on, and soon I'll hear old winter's song. But I miss you most of all, my darling, when autumn leaves start to fall. The falling leaves drift by the window. The autumn leaves of red and gold. I see your lips, the summer kisses, the sunburned hands I used to hold since you went away. The days grow long, and soon I'll hear old winter's song. But I miss you most of all, my darling, when start to fall.
Boy, what a great singer. Yeah. So let's head south. You've probably been wondering, where was Elvis? You know, I haven't hardly mentioned Elvis in 1955. That's because Elvis was just kind of barnstorming the South. Luckily, you know, for him, Colonel Parker, for all of his faults, knew that Elvis needed some mentoring. He was just a young kid. He had natural presence. He could sing, but he didn't know how to read music. He could barely play the guitar. He was all over the place on the stage, and he knew that he needed to be seasoned. And so both Parker and Sam Phillips, who still had his contract, basically was just letting him tour throughout the South and the Midwest and the Southwest, gaining his regional reputation. He was called the Hillbilly Cat, by the way, at this time. But they also knew that if Elvis was going to go anywhere, he was going to have to get out of Sun Records. Sun Records was just a small record label. And at this time, these small record labels, when they printed a record, they put them out on consignment. They didn't know if they were going to sell or not. And so, you know, what happened would be Sam Phillips would spend all of his money putting of an Elvis record out and hoping it would pay off. And it did, but it just, you know, it was just constant coming back and forth. He wasn't really making a lot of money because he would have to take that money that he made and put it back into more records for Elvis. So he knew that he couldn't hang on to Elvis. He knew Elvis was going to be a superstar. Tom Parker knew he's going to be a superstar. And so reluctantly, Sam Phillips decided he was going to sell his contract. He allowed Parker to negotiate with RCA, and RCA finally brought his contract for $40,000. Now, that doesn't sound like a lot of money today, but folks, you got to remember, Elvis Presley was not a known commodity at this point. He was known in the South and in the Southwest, a little bit in the Midwest. But for the most part, Elvis was just a regional music star, and he wasn't even really a star. So for RCA to negotiate and give him a contract of or give Sam Phillips $40,000 to assume Elvis's contract was a huge deal. And of course, they had the resources to promote Elvis. And boy, did they start promoting him, as we will see next year in 1956, because 1956 was the year that Elvis broke out across America. And when he broke out, I mean, it was just the biggest thing that's probably ever hit the music world. And I'm not exaggerating that. It was probably the biggest phenomena of all time in the music world. In the long run, it was a big deal for all sides. RCA got a musical act that was probably the biggest revenue-producing act of all time. Elvis and Parker both would become extremely rich. Sam Phillips did okay because now he had money, and he had money to kind of develop his growing stable of artists. He had Carl Perkins, he had Johnny Cash. Jerry Lee Lewis was going to burst upon the scene here in 1957. He would sign Roy Orbison, and all these people would become gigantic stars and make Sam Phillips a wealthy man. None of this could have happened if he wouldn't have signed his contract with RCA, because Sam didn't have the resources to develop him. So as it turned out, it turned out okay for all sides. And here's a photograph of Elvis, of course, signing his contract at the RCA representative there. And that's Sam Phillips. He's smiling, but he's also probably crying tears because he knows that he's let go of probably the greatest musical act of all time. So at that point, Sam Phillips began to develop his stable of stars, primarily in what's called the rockabilly genre. And the first one was Carl Perkins. And Carl Perkins, folks, we kind of forget about Carl Perkins today. He just, you know, as I've said earlier in the trivia question, he had a serious wreck, which derailed his career for several months, and he just got lost. And he never really recovered as such. He kept recording, and he kept making some hits out there, but he just never became the big star that everybody thought he was going to be at first. Because in the beginning, folks, Carl Perkins was huge. Born in rural Tennessee, 1932, very poor. His parents were sharecroppers. He learned how to sing listening to the Southern gospel songs in his Baptist church. He worked alongside the black sharecroppers and listened to their field hollers, as they were called. When he was six, his father made him a guitar out of a cigar box and a broomstick. Folks, I actually remember as a kid doing this. I made a guitar out of a broomstick and a cigar box and some string. When I was a little kid, and I'd play around with it like I was a rock and roll star. That was about the extent of my career as a musician. But, I actually did that myself. A few years later, neighbor felt sorry for him, gave him an old Gene Autry guitar. And it was on that he taught himself how to pick out tunes he heard listening to the Grand Ole Opry. That was the ritual of the South. And a lot of the country to listen to the Grand Ole Opry on Saturday nights. And he would hear the songs and he would start picking them out. And he was just a natural born musician. He was a fantastic musician, really. Much better musician than either Johnny Cash or Elvis Presley maybe not Jerry Lee Lewis, Roy Orbison wasn't much of a musician. They could all sing. They just couldn't play musical instruments. Carl Perkins was a great musician, as you'll see here in a few moments. His family finally moved near Memphis. And when he was 14, he and his two brothers began playing for drinks out in local taverns, even though they weren't even 16. They would play nightclubs and the taverns and the honky-tonks at night, just teenagers, but they'd let them play, and in return, they got drinks. You know, 1953, he married, became a father, had some children, was working full-time at the Colonial Bakery in Memphis. But every night, he'd go out and play local nightclubs, just honing his craft. Finally, someone said, you know, you really ought to go try to do a recording out in Sun Records. And so he got up the courage. It said that he went there three or four times and couldn't go in the door because he was scared. He was just, he wasn't an established music star at all, just playing local honky tonks. Finally went in, got an audition with Sam Phillips. He was very impressed with him. He said, you know, you can sing. You've got a pretty good look. You're a great musician, but I don't really like your songs. And so he told him, he said, if you go back and try to maybe write a song, because Carl Perkins wrote a lot of songs. And he said, go back and write a really good song. And when you do it, come back and we'll record it. Well, it didn't take him long. In the next few weeks, he wrote Blue Suede Shoes, which was, without a doubt, folks, the biggest record he ever had. And it was covered by just tons of music artists, including Elvis Presley. Came back and recorded Blue Suede Shoes, and he was on his way. I mean, at that point, he just was becoming a gigantic star. So how did Blue Suede Shoes come about? There's really a neat story about it. Supposedly, after Phillips told him to go back and write a song, he was doing one of his concerts at his honky-tonk, and he said he noticed a couple right in front of the stage, really beautiful little girl dancing with her boyfriend, and all of a sudden, the guy stopped while Carl was playing, and he said, hey, don't step on my blue suede shoes. Apparently, he really got on to her about it because he was wearing blue suede shoes. And he said, I just thought, how crazy can you be? You've got a beautiful young girl there and you're worried about your shoes. Said he went home that night and he said he couldn't sleep. He said, I just kept thinking about that thing, blue suede shoes. Got up in the middle of the night, went down to the kitchen, tore open a paper sack and got out a pencil and wrote blue suede shoes in just that one night. And they started playing it in some of the concerts, and he got a great reaction. Went back to Sam Phillips at Sun Studios, and he said, hey, I've got a song you might like. Started playing it for him, and Sam Phillips said, I knew it was a gigantic hit the minute he started playing it. He said it just had everything there. And boy, was it a hit. It reached the top of the charts on Billboard's country, pop, and R&B charts. One of the few songs to ever do that. It would be the first million-selling record for Sun Records. He introduced it for the very first time on national TV on March 17th, 1956, when he sung it live on the Ozark Jubilee in Springfield, Missouri. Ozark Jubilee, as we'll talk about here in a few minutes, was a rival to Nashville. In fact, Kate Springfield very close became the country music capital of the world, other than Nashville, but eventually they lost out to Nashville. As it turned out, like I said, it didn't turn out the way everybody thought it was going to turn out for Carl because of his car wreck, and we'll talk about that in a few weeks. He never really changed his musical style. He played rockabilly the rest of his life, and of course, rockabilly kind of came out of favor within a couple of years, but he just, that was the only music he liked to play. And he just kept playing it. And, a lot of people think he was just as good a singer as Elvis. I don't know about that, but he was definitely a good singer. Really, he was a much better musician than Elvis as far as playing the guitar. And again, if it wouldn't have been for that cruel twist of fate, he may have been the king of rock and roll. Who knows? But it wasn't to be. 1987, he was inducted into the second class of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. So let's listen to Carl Perkins sing Blue Suede Shoes. This was at a TV show called The Ranch Party, hosted by Tex Ritter in 1957.
A very famous guest star on Ranch Party must have traveled west in his time and heard the cowboys say, "Don't you dare step on my patent leather boots, partner." Possibly went back home to Memphis, wrote a song, and he's here with us to sing it. Carl Perkins and his boys, Blue Suede Shoes.
Well, it's one for the money, two for the show. Three to get it ready. Now go, cat, go, but don't you step on my blue suede shoes. Put me off on my blue suede shoes. Yeah, well, you can knock me down, step in my face, slander my name all over the place. Can't do anything that you wanna do, but baby, lay off of my shoes. Don't you step on my blue suede shoes. Well, you can do anything, but lay off of my blue suede shoes. My car and drink my liquor from an old fruit jar. You do anything that you wanna do, but baby, lay off of them shoes, and don't you step on my blue suede shoes. Oh, you can do anything, but lay off of my blue suede shoes. Well, it's blue, blue, blue suede shoes. Blue, blue, blue suede shoes. Blue, blue, blue suede shoes, baby. Blue, blue, blue suede shoes. You do anything, but lay off of my blue suede shoes.
Okay, so that was Carl Perkins and Blue Suede Shoes. We'll hear more about Carl Perkins, but that was by far and away his biggest song. Now, there was another guy that Sam Phillips had in his stable at this time, a man by the name of Johnny Cash. What do we all know about Johnny Cash? There hasn't been too many music stars any bigger than Johnny Cash in the 50s and 60s and clear up into the 70s and 80s and 90s. Just a gigantic presence. So let's see how Johnny Cash got going. Just like Carl Perkins, he was born in rural Arkansas. And just like him, he grew up amongst the black people, working in the field, cotton fields. Just really a tough struggle for his family. Just really deep poverty. As a result, he grew up always having a real sympathy for the poor and the working class. And that showed. His songs almost totally were about, you know, the poor and the working class people. That's probably the only reason he became such a great success amongst the country music audience. It was because of that. Listened, raised up Southern gospel, listened just like Carl Perkins, listening to the field hollers. He never became a great musician. His if anything, he was probably even a worse musician than Elvis. Johnny just, you know, the guitar was a prop. That's all there is to it. But did he have a great, unique voice? I mean, his bass baritone voice was just fantastic and just stood out. 1950, he joined the Air Force, kind of honed his musical skills with a makeshift band while he was overseas. I think he was in Germany, and came back, got married, moved to Memphis, Tennessee, and decided he was going to be a radio announcer. He thought he could do that, and then he had the voice for it. But then he decided he wanted to try recording a few songs. Now, he was primarily a gospel singer at this point. He wasn't really a rhythm and blues or rock and roll or rockabilly. He didn't really sing much of that. He was singing primarily gospel songs. Went to Sun Studios, and the story goes, Phillip said, "Hey, you got a great voice. Why don't you go home and send some and then come back for the record I can sell?" Now, I don't know if that happened or not. That's Sam Phillips' version of the story. Johnny Cash never really verified that happened, but that's what Sam Phillips said. A few weeks later, he returned, just like Carl Perkins, had written a couple of songs. One of them was Hey Porter, which he always sung at all his concerts, one of his very first songs. But the big one was Folsom Prison Blues. Now, it sounds just like something like, you know, why would he write a letter about Folsom Prison Blues? Well, it turned out to be a really big thing because it kind of made him identify with the poor and the mistrodden and the downtrodden of the earth. And he just really became just a gigantic star. In fact, the case, there were only three people currently in the rock and roll, the country, and the gospel's halls of fame. Three people: Elvis, Johnny Cash, and Dolly Parton. Dolly Parton just went into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and a little bit of controversy about that, even from her at one point. But you know, at this point, there's only three people that have been good enough to be in all three of those rock and roll, all three of those halls of fame, and that's Elvis, Dolly, and Johnny Cash. So here's an early publicity. So how did he come to write Folsom Prison Blues, his first big song and one of his signature songs? You know, every great musical artist seems to have a signature song. If you're really great, you got a whole lot of signature songs. Elvis has so many signature songs, you probably can't list them all. Johnny Cash has at least three, you know. So it was one of his great signature songs that everybody just knows when you hear it, you're hearing Johnny Cash. The story goes, he was in the Air Force, as I told you, in Germany, Landsberg, Germany, which was the site of a famous prison for former Nazi war criminals. And they had seen a movie. They showed movies to the Air Force personnel at their barracks and all. And one of them was inside the walls of Folsom Prison. I guess they were trying to tell the people not to do wrong, you know, or you'll go to prison. And that just kind of reminded him of that. And Cash took the melody for the song and some of the lyrics from a song that was already written in 1953 by Gordon Jenkins called Crescent City Blues. Eventually, Cash would have to settle a lawsuit over that. Jenkins would sue him for Folsom Prison Blues for royalties, and he eventually settled for a $75,000 cash outlay in the 1970s because he did indeed basically steal the melody and even some of the lyrics from Crescent City Blues. But by that time, it was such a huge hit that, you know, the guy was probably happy to get $75,000. And Johnny Cash was such a huge music star at that point. He was often asked, he said, how in the world did you come up with that line, but I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die? And he said, well, I tried to think up the worst reason a person could have for killing another person. That's what came to mind. And he put that in the song, and that line just still kind of stands out there. By the way, 1968, Johnny Cash went to Folsom Prison and introduced that song to the inmate population. He often, it wasn't the first prison he'd recorded at. He actually recorded the first time at San Quentin in 1960. And by the way, one of the prisoners sitting on the front row was a little young man by the name of Merle Haggard. And Merle Haggard was just absolutely so impressed with Johnny Cash, he thought, I think I can do that. And of course, you know, he did. He became one of the great music stars in country music. Johnny Cash always had empathy with the prisoners. And he kind of became known as the man in black because he always wore black because he wanted to express his support. So let's listen to Johnny Cash early in his career singing Folsom Prison Blues.
I hear the train a-coming, it's rolling around the bend, and I ain't seen the sunshine. I don't know when I'm stuck in Folsom Prison, and time keeps dragging on. But that train keeps rolling on down to San Antone. When I was just a baby, my mama told me, son, Always be a good boy, don't ever play with guns. But I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die. When I hear that whistle blowing, I hang my head and cry. From this prison, if that railroad train's mine, that I'd move it on a little farther down the line, far from Folsom Prison. That's where I want to stay. And I'd let that lonesome whistle blow my blues away.
Okay, so Johnny Cash would go on to have just a super big career, just hundreds of records, albums all over the place. Of course, we remember him for I Walked the Line and, Ring of Fire, just constant songs. Had his own TV show for many years. He was just a huge star in country music. I was actually lucky enough to see Johnny Cash one time when he was playing in Branson, not too far from here, and got to see him. And he was just an absolute treasure to watch. I mean, his voice is just so unique and so, so good. So let's kind of look at country music. Just like we looked at the pop music, let's see what the big hits of country music. Remember, at this point in time, you've got about four charts on the Billboard charts. You've got the rhythm and blues charts. You've got the pop music charts, which at this point would include primarily rock and roll songs songs like we listened to, like Nat King Cole. And then you would have the country music charts, which was different from all the rest of them. And then what eventually would be called easy listening. Which we'll hear a lot of those songs. So what were the biggest songs of 1955 in country music? Well, one of them was There She Goes by Carl Smith, Yellow Roses by Hank Snow, If You Ain't Lovin', You Ain't Livin' by Farron Young, I've Been Thinking by Eddie Arnold, Let Me Go, Lover by Hank Snow, Live Fast, Love Hard, Die Young, Farron Young, Loose Heart by Carl Smith, That Do Make It Nice by Webb Pierce. Webb Pierce was just a huge star in country music in the early 50s. We'll hear more about him. Why Baby Why by Webb Pierce was number two. The biggest song of 1955 was from a man that was born and raised about, 70, 80 miles from where I sit, Porter Wagoner, A Satisfied Mind. Now, he wasn't the only one that recorded that song. At the same time, his country music song, Satisfied Mind, was the number one hit. It had also been recorded by Red Foley, who was one of the biggest stars in country music early in the 1950s, and eventually the host of the Ozark Jubilee. My mind got lost here. Jeannie Shepherd also recorded and had a big hit. So three people had big hits with Satisfied Mind all at the same time. I'm going to show you a recording from the Grand Ole Opry the Ozark Jubilee in 1955, where those three people are singing that song as a trio. It's a really neat part. So let's talk about the Ozark Jubilee. Red Foley started the Ozark Jubilee. He had become a big star in the 1940s and 50s. He sold over 25 million records. People forget just how big a star Red Foley was. He also became the host, as I said, of the Ozark Jubilee from 1955 to 1960. It was the first nationally broadcast country music show in America, and came right here to Springfield, Missouri, Jewel Theater downtown. It made Springfield kind of an early rival to Nashville as the country music capital. In fact, the case, there was kind of a dispute going on there for a few years about which one was going to be the biggest. Eventually, Nashville went out. It was a bigger city. It were more, was more cosmopolitan, had been noted for a long time as an insurance capital of America. And the record companies just felt more at ease putting their big money into records to recording studios in Nashville. And that's what made Nashville the country music capital, when all the big country, all the big recording companies went to Nashville and started opening up studios. Of course, it had the Grand Ole Opry, which was the biggest at that time radio show in America, but Springfield had the Ozark Jubilee. Now, Foley, I remember I grew up listening to the Ozark Jubilee. That was a Saturday night ritual in my house. You listen to the Ozark Jubilee on KYTV. After that was wrestling from the Shrine Mosque. I can tell you all sorts of stories in my mind. I remember this so well because that, you know, my dad insisted we watch it. He knew a few of these old people because they ran around Springfield like Slim Wilson and some of these people, Speedy Hayworth and all. Some of you guys out there that are local people, I know those names are familiar to you. Some of you doubt may not remember them, but they were big people at that time. Foley had kind of a hard career. He struggled with alcohol most of his life. He often had to take kind of sabbaticals from the show and have guest hosts because he went and dried out. He also had some kind of bad struggles with his own personal life. His second wife, he was married several times. Second wife actually killed herself over his affair that he was having with the country music star. And he ended up marrying her about two or three weeks after his wife killed herself. And today that would probably ruin a man's career. Back in these days, it was just kind of a blink. Nobody thought, well, he's living a country music song. Nevertheless, he's considered one of the giants. He was one of the very first inductees in the Country Music Hall of Fame, 1967, died the next year, 1968. On his show, some of the biggest names in country music came through. I mean, you name them, they were there at that point. Patsy Cline, Brenda Lee actually got her start on the Ozark Jubilee. Many, many more, but one of the very first ones that got their start on the Ozark Jubilee was Porter Wagner from West Plains, Missouri. He had recorded a song written by a janitor in Springfield by the name of Johnny Mullins. I'm going to tell you about Johnny Mullins in a minute. Johnny Mullins has written a song called Company's Coming. He wrote hundreds of songs, and some of them were pretty big, folks. This song became just a huge country music hit. Later on, of course, Porter Wagner is known for hosting his own TV show for two decades and jump-starting a career of one of the biggest stars in not just country music, but anywhere, Dolly Parton. And, of course, he himself inducted into the Hall of Fame, Country Music Hall of Fame in 2002. Also, another big star that got her start on the Ozark Jubilee was regular with Jeannie Shepherd. Came from Bakersfield, California. And at all three of these people had the same song as a hit record at the same time. And she was one of the first women to join the Grand Ole Opry. And she herself was inducted into the Country Music Hall of Fame in 2011. So let's look at Porter Wagner, Red Foley, and Jeannie Shepherd singing Satisfied Mind, the biggest country music song of 1955.
Oh, well, you know, here's a young man that says he has to look up the chimney. That is, he lives so far back in the hills, he has to look up the chimney to call the cows home. Porter Wagner, Porter, come here. I tell you, I imagine you'd like to plug your latest record tonight, wouldn't you?
Well, yes, I would, Red. I have a real brand new one called A Satisfied Mind.
I recorded that, too.
That's what I hear you did. By the way, I wonder, could we work out something here, you and me?
Why don't we just both sing a duet on it?
Well, hey, There's a little gal that recorded this too, Red.
How about
Jeannie Shepherd?
Well, I tell you, folks, this is sort of a...
I was just wondering when y'all can give me
a plug. Stay right in here. This is sort of a slick way that we had a plug in our record. All three of us have a record of the same tune. And in order to get it all in, we thought, well, maybe it'd be a nice idea if we just sang a trio on it. Here it is, Porter Wagoner, Jeannie Shepherd, myself, and Satisfied Mind, huh?
If you're interested, there's a whole lot of episodes of the Ozark Jubilee that have been digitized and are on the internet. All you have to do is just type in Ozark Jubilee videos, and you're going to find a whole bunch of them if you're really interested in watching. So I've not watched all of them. I've watched a few of them, kind of refreshed my memory about the old days and growing up as a young kid. So I want to finish. I like to highlight anybody that's come from the Springfield area, because that's where I'm broadcasting from, and I have a lot of people out there that listen to my show from the Springfield area. I like to mention anyone that was associated with the music scene. And boy, did we have a big one in Springfield when it came to country music. Had several, but one of the big ones was Johnny Mullins. And Johnny Mullins was one of those really unique characters. Born in rural Berry County, Missouri, spent most of his days playing the guitar in the barn because his father refused to let him play it in the house. He thought it was such a bad thing. Finally, he heard Johnny singing a song called Rabbit in the Briar Patch that Johnny had written, and he finally decided to let him start singing songs in the house. Eventually, he moved to Springfield, got married, went on to work full-time retired from the Springfield public school systems in 1982 as a janitor. Never, you know, he was never a big guy. He was always just a very common man living in a very small house. But he just wrote hundreds of songs. And one of his first ones that became a big hit was Company's Coming. But folks, he wrote some huge songs. Probably the biggest was Blue Kentucky Girl, which was sung by Loretta Lynn, actually was nominated for a Grammy Award. Johnny had all sorts of, you know, people were trying to get him to go to Nashville to write songs. And he said, nope, I'm staying in Springfield, Missouri, and I've got to retire from the school system working as a janitor. And that's what he did. He never left Springfield. He was just always a very humble, pleasant man. Died in 2009 at the age of 86, and there's Johnny Mullins right there. So next week, we're going to start 1956, the year of Elvis. Elvis now has a contract with RCA. He's freed from Sun Records. He's got Tom Parker as his manager, and he literally explodes up on the scene in 1956. I mean, the world has never seen anything like it. And that's what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about other stars of 1956 because he was by far and away not the only one. He was just the biggest one. So that's it for today. I hope you've enjoyed it. I appreciate you listening in, and we will see you next week.
Hey,
good job.
We missed last week. How do I get that? How do I get it on YouTube?
The Ozark Jubilee?
No, your program last week. Maybe Kaylin can tell me.
If you will go to Arrow Senior Living YouTube, four words, not together, just type that in as a search. It will bring you to called Arrow Senior Living YouTube. Hit that, and it will bring you up to where you can see all the videos that Arrow has. And if you'll see something called playlist, hit the playlist and you will see all my recordings there.
Okay.
Go on, everybody.
Every one I've ever done for Arrow.
Okay.
Most like public schools, they didn't have books.
And Donna, I'm looking now to make sure that last week's was uploaded. If it is, I'll just send you the link directly.
Yeah. Okay. It was.
Oh, good. Okay, cool. Katarina is the one that updates them for me, so I count on her. So I figured it was, but yeah. So I can also send you the link, Donna, so you have it. Like Tony was explaining, that way you can get to it quickly.
Okay. And we came in late on this one. Art had a dentist appointment, so maybe we can watch this one over too. So
yep, it'll be added as well. Katarina adds them every week for us.
Well, good. Okay. Thank you. Okay. Thank you.
We will see you next week.
Yes. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.